ज्ञान तिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुष उन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स पदांतिकं। वंदेहं श्रीगुर श्रीयुता पदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश श्रीरूपं सागरजातं सहगना रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजना सहितं कृष्ण चैतन्य देवं श्रीराधा कृष्ण पादं सहगना ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितं च नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रस्थाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे वंचाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पापनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। नमो महावदन्नाय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नाम्ने गौरतिष्ये नमः। हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंध जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधाकांत नमस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी विषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। मुखम करति वाचलम पंगुर्लंघायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्रीकृष्णतारिणं परमानंद माधवं श्रीचैतन्येश्वरम्। Hare Krishna, welcome everyone for the last day of our discussion. And we have been discussing about subduing Kaliya by Krishna. So in our last discussion, day before yesterday, we are discussing that how the Brajavasis, the devotees of Krishna in Vrindavan, those who are staying back at the villages, they saw some bad omens. In the sky, they also saw the bad omen on the earth, and they also saw bad omen in their bodies. And as soon as they saw the bad omens, they started thinking the imminent danger which can cause Krishna into trouble. So they are very Krishna conscious. Whatever happens to their lives in Vrindavan, so they always think of Krishna. So that is a basic principle of Krishna consciousness. Krishna consciousness means Krishna is the center. So for the devotees of Vrindavan, they are always thinking of Krishna. So when they saw the bad omen also, they did not think about their own danger. They thought about the danger of their beloved Krishna. And that is the principle of Krishna consciousness. Krishna consciousness means we have to be replaced by Krishna. Krishna should be the center in this material world. I and who are related to me are the center of our lives. And that is the principle of material existence. But the Brajavasis, the devotees of Vrindavan, their life is completely opposite. The center of their lives is Krishna. So how they came to Krishna? They follow in the footsteps of Krishna because they saw the footprints of Krishna on the dust of Vrindavan. So Krishna in Vrindavan, he does not use shoes. He walks barefoot. That is one of the symptom of Vrindavan. Krishna does not use shoes. He is always barefoot. So Mother Yashoda told Krishna that you should use shoes. I have arranged shoes for you because there are so many thorns, pebbles, stones in the forest, in the pasture ground. So your lotus feet, your feet is so soft, so tender. So in order to protect your tender feet, I have arranged a beautiful pair of shoes. You should use that. So Krishna said, yeah, good, very good. But I cannot wear shoes without having the arrangement of the shoes of all the cows and calves. So all of you know that Nanda Maharaj had 900,000 cows. And each cow has four legs. So if Mother Yashoda has to arrange shoes for all the cows, then how many shoes she has to arrange? So 9 lakhs, which is 900,000 multiplied by 4, 36 lakhs shoes to be arranged. So Mother Yashoda gave up the idea. But in reciprocation of love of Krishna, what the cows did? The cows used their hoofs, strong hoofs, and broke and smashed all the stones and pebbles of Vrindavan and made them into dust, soft dust, just like the soft powder, so that the lotus feet of Krishna do not have to go through the trouble. To give the comfort to the lotus feet, the cows, they have rendered a wonderful service by making all the stones and pebbles of Vrindavan into very, very soft powder-like dust. And that is the road of Vrindavan on which Krishna used to walk, run without any shoes. That is the symptom of Vrindavan. So while Krishna goes barefoot, so there are some transcendental mark on the lotus feet of Krishna, which we discussed in our last discussion. There are many auspicious marks. There's an elephant goat and thunderbolt. There are so many wonderful marks on the lotus feet of Krishna, and that marks are there on the dust of Vrindavan. So it's like the footprints of Krishna. But another beautiful feature of Vrindavan is that when the devotees of Vrindavan, they see the footprints of Krishna on the dust of Vrindavan, they don't overstep on that. But to talk about the devotees, everybody is devotee in Vrindavan, even the human forms, they don't step on. Even the animals, they also don't step on. Nobody steps on the footprint of Krishna. That's why Krishna's footprints remain intact. So following in that footprints, all the devotees of Vrindavan, they came at the bank of Kaliya Lake. So they saw Krishna is bound, Krishna is entrapped, Krishna is encased into the coil of Kaliya. And by seeing that condition of Krishna, they were overwhelmed. And they are in anxiety, they are in fear, they are in lamentation. And they are almost in the position of giving up their bodies They're in tremendous anxiety. The question may arise that why Krishna gives anxiety to his devotees? Krishna gives anxieties to his devotees to intensify their love for him. When the beloved is in difficult situation, the lovers go through anxiety. And when the lovers go through that anxiety because of the condition of the beloved, their love for the beloved intensifies. And Krishna experiences tremendous joy by seeing the intense love of the Brajavasis. So everything is about love. That is Vrindavan. And Krishna wants to intensify that love. The love of the Brajavasis is already intense. It is unlimited. But still Krishna wants to increase that. So in order to increase that love of the Brajavasis, Krishna put them into anxiety. But when anxiety was too much, then Krishna started thinking, if I continue like this, then Brajavasis may give up their bodies. They may die. So therefore, Krishna changed his action. Now he started expanding himself. He became very, very heavy, and he became so heavy that Kaliya could not hold him in his coil, and Krishna came out of the coil. And he was playing in the water, and Kaliya wanted to bite him again. He was trying, and Krishna was playing. Krishna loves to play. Such a dangerous snake, but Krishna was fearless because Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And he wants to deliver Kaliya also. So Krishna was moving around and Kaliya was trying to bite him. Then Krishna came on the hood. He started climbing on the hood of Kaliya. And Kaliya had 1,000 hoods. And with that hood, Kaliya was trying to bite Krishna. And you know, the hood of the snakes is slippery. So many hoods. And the Kaliya, he was trying to bite Krishna with those hoods. But Krishna was so expert. He was dancing on the hood. Not only playing, he was dancing expertly on that slippery hood of Kaliya. And not only one hood, 1,000 hoods. And that's why Krishna is known as expert dancer. He is the most expert dancer in the creation. And he was dancing on a nice stage. What was the stage? It was a slippery stage, the hood of a tremendously poisonous snake, Kaliya. And not only one hood, many hoods. And Krishna was jumping, placing his feet so expertly, and he was dancing. And by seeing this wonderful dance performance of Krishna, the inhabitants of the upper planetary system, the Swargaloka, they were in jubilation. And they started playing musical instruments. They started throwing flowers. It was a celebration for them. It was a festival for them because Krishna was performing a wonderful pastime by dancing on the slippery hood of Kaliya. And Krishna's feet was showing the effulgence because of the light coming from the jewels which are there on the hood of Kaliya. So this kind of exceptional snakes, they generally have jewels on their hoods. So the light effulgence was emanating from those jewels on the hood of Kaliya, and Krishna's lotus feet was glittering with that light, and it was a wonderful lighting, and because of that it was really wonderful. It was becoming a wonderful dance performance. It was music, it was a musical performance, and in that music, in that light, the super dancer, the expert dancer, the Nataraj, the most expert dancer Krishna was dancing on the stage. The stage was the slippery hood of Kaliya, and it was a wonderful dance performance. And by seeing that dance, the devotees of Vrindavan, they are also very jubilant and happy. But even Krishna was dancing, still Kaliya was trying to bite him. And Kaliya used to raise his hood. And whichever hood he was raising, Krishna was jumping on that hood and subduing that hood by his power. So in that way, one hood after another, all the hoods were subdued by Krishna by his tremendous weight. Krishna can become lighter than the lightest, and he can also become heavier than the heaviest. So Krishna here became heavier than the heaviest. Very heavy, just like the weight of the universe. And Kaliya could not tolerate that heaviness. He became very, very tired. Very tired. And what was happening? So his energy, the strength started reducing. He started losing his energy. And also the poison was coming out from his mouth. Not only the poison, the blood was also coming out from his mouth. And in that way, by this process of Krishna dancing on the hood of Kaliya, slowly the poisonous effects were released. So slowly, by the contact of Krishna, by the transcendental touch of Krishna, by the transcendental mercy of Krishna, then Kaliya went through the purification. He became free from the poison, both in terms of consciousness and also the physical poison. Poison was coming out from his mouth, and poison also coming out from his heart. And poison in his heart was in the form of envy. So Krishna cured Kaliya from envy, and Kaliya became pure. And in that process, Kaliya gave up his pride, because envy is connected with the pride. And when a person is free from envy, then he becomes humble. So here, Krishna made Kaliya humble by humiliating. Humiliation led to humility. So that is the way Krishna does. Some people go through the humiliation and becomes humble. The proud people, those who are very, very proud, unless they go through humiliation, it's very difficult for them to become humble. And Krishna knows that. Krishna is an expert doctor. He knows what kind of medicine a patient needs. So a person who is very, very proud, a person who is very, very envious because of that pride, he has to go through humiliation. And Krishna has arranged this, and he humiliated Kaliya in front of his wives, in front of his children, in front of all the Brajavasis. Kaliya was humiliated like anything by Krishna. But this humiliation was the expression of Krishna, because through this process of humiliation, Kaliya became humble. And he took shelter of Krishna in the mind. is surrendered. So this is the process. Bhakti begins with surrender. Arjuna also surrendered to Krishna. Then Krishna started speaking Bhagavad Gita. So unless we surrendered, bhakti or devotional service does not begin. That's why Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mam Ekam Saranam Braja. So give up all everything and just surrender unto me. So bhakti means saranagati, saranagati means bhakti. Surrender is devotional service means surrender. So Kaliya started the process of surrender by the mercy of Krishna. Although Kaliya did not have any qualification, then why Kaliya got this mercy? Unless you have some qualification, you don't get mercy. But Kaliya, apparently, he did not have any quality. He was a snake. He was in a snake body. He was very, very envious. He wanted to kill Krishna. All bad qualities are there. Still, Krishna was merciful to Kaliya. He wanted to deliver him. He wanted to purify him. Why? Because Kaliya was a devotee in his last life. And one other devotee came to do the austerity, where this Kaliya in his previous life, he was a muni, he was a saintly person. And he told that other muni, other saintly person, why you have come to my area? Here I am performing the austerity. And the other saintly person became very upset. He said, you are a saintly person, but you are acting like an envious person. You are acting like a snake. So I curse you that you become a snake. And after getting the curse, he also cursed back. So you are cursing me for a small offense. You curse me like that. It will, you'll become a snake and you'll be harassed by Garuda also. So he was giving curse after curse. So this muni who got the curse, he cursed back. He said, you're cursing me. I am cursing you also that you become a crow. So when these two devotees are cursing each other, so Vishnu came and said, your devotees, you should not act like that. Sometimes devotees make mistakes because of their certain impurities. Unless we become completely pure, there is always a chance to make mistake. Even a practicing devotee can make mistake. We have seen in Srimad Bhagavatam, a devotee in high standard also can make mistake. Bharat Maharaj made a mistake. Parikshit Maharaj made a mistake. But this mistake sometimes is because of the impurities of the devotee, and sometimes it is because of the desire of Krishna also to perform the pastime. So whatever may be the reason, there will be a mistake. To err is human. So we all make mistakes. But what is the glory of a devotee? He immediately recognizes the mistake and goes through the process of rectification. So making mistake is normal, because that is the natural thing in this material world, because we are all conditioned souls, and making mistakes is a normal thing. But a sadhaka, a practicing devotee who is very, very sincere, he recognizes the mistake and he rectifies that mistake and he does not repeat that mistake. So this muni, he was cursed, and because of that, he became a snake. But Krishna told that you are all devotees, but you made the mistake, but I bless you. You become a part of my pastime. You'll be able to take part in my pastime. And because he was a devotee, so Kaliya, although he got the body of a snake, but by the mercy of the Supreme Lord, he was able to participate in the pastime of Krishna. And Krishna chose Kaliya to show to the whole world that how an envious person also can be cured from this problem by the mercy of the Supreme Lord. So Kaliya got the mercy because he was a devotee. So we have to learn that Krishna gives mercy when someone practices pure devotional service. Even if he makes mistake, Krishna does not withdraw his mercy, because Krishna is very, very merciful. And he wants to see that his devotees become purified, his devotees become perfect, his devotees become liberated. So Kaliya got the mercy. So when Kaliya surrendered, then his wives, Nagapatnis, along with their children, came in front of the Lord. And they started praying. And the wives of the Kaliya, they were very chaste. They were the chaste women. And they wanted to beg forgiveness from Krishna for the misdeeds of their husband. So the Nagapatnis, the wives of the Kaliya, they started praying to the Supreme Lord. So how a devotee connects with the Lord, reciprocates with the Lord? By praying. Prayer is very, very powerful. Prayer is the expression of our heart. So therefore, we have to learn how to pray. Praying is one of the items of pure devotional service. Prahlad Maharaj explains 9 processes of devotional service. Sravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasham, Shakkam, Atma Nivedanam, Iti Pungsarvita Vishnu, Bhaktista, Navalakshana. There are 9 processes, starting with hearing and chanting, but it also talks about Vandanam. Vandanam is prayer. So prayer is one of the item of 9 devotional services, 9 processes of devotional service. So here, Nagapatnis are praying to the Supreme Lord. And what they are praying? They are telling the Supreme Lord, they are telling that the punishment you have given to our husband is completely perfect. It's appropriate punishment you have given. Whatever he has done, he got the appropriate punishment from you. So, by this we can understand the situation, the position of a good devotee. So, Nagapatnis are wonderful devotees. And they glorified the act of Krishna, because they know how Krishna acts. Generally, what happens if somebody does something to somebody's husband, generally that wife will chastise that person who has punished her husband. But here, these wives are not ordinary wives. They are just wives. At the same time, they are also devotees of the Lord. And they knew how the Supreme Lord acts. They knew the principle of devotional service. They knew the relationship between devotee and the Supreme Lord. So therefore, they congratulated the Supreme Lord Krishna for showing his mercy to their husband in the form of this punishment, in the form of that humiliation to Kaliya, because that was needed for Kaliya to purify. That was needed for Kaliya to come back to his original position as a devotee of the Lord. So, the devotees of the Lord they always glorify Krishna for his activities. So Nagapatnis glorified the Supreme Lord. They also told Krishna that please forgive him because you are very merciful. And without your mercy, how he will be delivered? And Nagapatnis also glorified Kaliya. He said that Kaliya is very fortunate. Generally, the munis, the rishis, the great yogis, they go through so many austerities, severe austerities. Even after that, they don't have darshan of the lotus feet of the Lord. But here Kaliya, who is envious of Krishna, who is having poison in his heart and his body is made of poison, he wanted to kill Krishna. Even after that, you have given your mercy, our dear Lord, by dancing on his hood and by putting your lotus feet on the head of our husband. So how fortunate Kaliya is. And that is the symptom of Kripa Siddhi. Kaliya got the mercy of the Supreme Lord. It was causeless. And the wives of Kaliya, they are surprised by this wonderful, merciful act of Krishna. And when devotees are in front of the Lord, pleading for someone, praying for someone, Lord becomes very merciful. So mercy of the Lord flows through the devotees. The mercy of the Lord does not flow directly. That's why it is said, if you want to get the mercy of the Lord, then you have to take shelter of the devotee. So that is the system. And that system is eternal system. That's why Krishna says that whoever thinks that he is my devotee, he is not my devotee. But whoever is a devotee of my devotee is my devotee. That's why it is said, Aradhananang Sarvasang, Lord Shiva says, Vishnu Aradhanang Param, Tasmat Paratara Devi, Todiyanam Samarchanam. So Lord Shiva says, the worship of Vishnu is the topmost worship. But worship of the devotees of Vishnu is greater than the worship of Vishnu. So that is the system. Krishna is more pleased when he sees that his devotees are pleased by the service. So therefore, if we want to get the mercy of the Supreme Lord, then we have to serve the devotees. Here, Kaliya is getting the mercy of the Supreme Lord because Kaliya's wives, they are praying to the Supreme Lord for the mercy. So therefore, if we want to continue our devotional service, if we want to start our devotional service, if you want to get the mercy of the Supreme Lord, if you want to get perfection in our spiritual journey, everything depends on the mercy, prayers of the devotees of the Supreme Lord. So Bhakta Sangha, Sadhu Sangha, is the birthplace of Bhakti. The Lord also says that I don't reside in Vaikuntha. Naham tishtami vaikunthe yoginam hidaye shiva tatra tishtami narada yatra gayanti mad bhakta. So Krishna says, I don't reside in Vaikuntha planet. Krishna says, I don't reside in the heart of a yogi. Lord says, I reside in those places where my devotees glorify me. So, Bhakta Sangha is the birthplace of Bhakti. Sadhu Sangha is the birthplace of Bhakti. So, therefore, if you want to get the mercy of the Lord, If we want to start our bhakti, if you want to continue our bhakti, if you want to sustain our devotional life, if you want to perfect our devotional life, Sadhu Sangha is the only way. That's why Srila Prabhupada, the founder Acharya of ISKCON, has established this society so that people in any parts of the world can have this Sadhu Sangha. That is the purpose of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, to give the opportunity to anyone and everyone in any part of the world to have Sadhu Sangha, because without Sadhu Sangha, we cannot get the mercy of the Lord. We cannot get bhakti at the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. So here, Kaliya is getting the mercy of the Supreme Lord. He is getting the pure devotional service to the Supreme Lord because of the prayers of his wives. Those are great devotees of the Supreme Lord. Then Krishna become very merciful. And after Nagapadni is prayed, then Kaliya also prayed. Then Lord told Kaliya that you should not stay in Vrindavan. You should go to the ocean where from you came. Because Kaliya used to stay in ocean in a distant place, but Garuda was harassing him because Kaliya was taking the offering of other snakes which are supposed to be taken by Garuda. And Kaliya used to take that, and Garuda became very upset. And Garuda was chasing behind Kaliya, and Kaliya was moving from here and there, from different lower planetary system. And ultimately he came to a place where, in this Kaliya lake. And in that Kaliya lake, Garuda cannot come. Why? Because Sauvari Muni was performing tapasya in that lake. And Garuda used to come to take fishes, but out of the compassion for the fishes, Sauvari Muni stopped Garuda to take those fishes and told Garuda to not to come here. So in that way, Garuda was not stopped to come to this lake. And it was a safe place for Kaliya to come. That's why Kaliya took shelter of that lake. And but now Krishna is telling, although he gave the mercy to Kaliya, but Krishna told Kaliya, leave Vrindavan, because envy and Vrindavan do not match. There is no place of envy in Vrindavan. There is no place of envy in the spiritual world. So if we want to enter into Vrindavan Dham, if you want to stay in Vrindavan Dham, we have to give up envy. And that is the message of this pastime. There are so many messages, but one of the main messages of this pastime is that if we want to live in Vrindavan, if we want to attain perfection in our spiritual life, if we want to get the mercy of the Supreme Lord, envy has to be given up. So Krishna helped Kaliya to come out from this envy, but he is also giving a message that envy has no place in Vrindavan. So Kaliya left Vrindavan and he went to his own place, and Kaliya told, if I go, then Garuda may attack me again. But Krishna told that, don't worry, Kaliya, now Garuda will not attack you. Garuda will not disturb you. He said, why? He said that now there is a mark on your head. The mark of my lotus feet are there. So when Garuda will see the mark of the lotus feet on your head, Garuda will not disturb you. So therefore, if we have the mark of the lotus feet of Krishna on our head, nothing of this material world can disturb us. So therefore, we have to take shelter of the lotus feet of Krishna. We have to keep the lotus feet of Krishna on our head. means we have to take shelter of the lotus feet of Krishna. Then we are safe in this dangerous material world. There is no safe place in this world. Srimad Bhagavatam explains, padam padam yad vipadam. At every step there is danger in this material world. And how we can remain safe even in this dangerous material world? By taking shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. And that lotus feet is represented also in the form of Sadhu Sangha. When you take shelter of the lotus feet of the pure devotees, that is also equal to taking shelter of the lotus feet of Krishna. Because Krishna's mercy, Krishna's shelter is available only through the shelter of his representative, the pure devotees of the Lord. So if we want to be safe in this material world, if we want to be completely protected from the danger of this material world, what we have to do? We have to take shelter of the pure devotees of the Lord. Then we are in safe place. And in that way, Kaliya was delivered, and through this pastime, Krishna is showing to the whole world that how, by this wonderful act, he delivered Kaliya, also he protected the devotees of Vrindavan. So one act played two different roles. He protected the devotees, also he protected the demon. And in that way, Krishna is showing his wonderful, merciful nature. So Krishna is merciful both to the demons and also to the devotees. But he shows his mercy in different ways, because every patient needs a particular medicine. So demons need the medicine of being chastised, being killed, in order to be purified. So Krishna shows his mercy to the demons by killing them, by chastising them, by subduing them. And he shows the same mercy to his devotees by giving the protection to them, by giving his loving reciprocation to them. So both are equal, because the purpose is the same. Purpose is to perfect their life so that they can go back home, back to Godhead. Krishna wants to see that every conditioned soul becomes a pure devotee of the Lord and goes back home, back to Godhead. We are suffering in this world because this world is the world of suffering. And only way we can be free from this suffering is by the mercy of the Lord. And when we are out of this material world, and Krishna wants to make sure that how we can be out of this material world and out of this danger and enter into his eternal abode. And when Krishna completed his pastime of subduing Kaliya, the devotees were so happy. Devotees of Vrindavan were overjoyed. And they are also in a very difficult situation when Krishna was in the clutches of Kaliya, when Krishna was enwrapped in the coils of Kaliya. But after that, they are overjoyed. And it is explained that by this pastime, Krishna united all the devotees of Vrindavan. In Govardhan Lila, Krishna united all the devotees over 7 days and seven nights. But here, Krishna at least united all the devotees. He brought all the devotees of Vrindavan. Krishna always wants the association of the devotees together. Generally, Krishna does not have that opportunity. Because when he is in the field, he is not having association of the gopis. When he is with the gopis, he does have association with his mothers. But by this kind of arrangement of these wonderful pastimes, Krishna can see all the devotees of Vrindavan together. And that gives him so much pleasure. So here in this pastime, Krishna derives so much pleasure. Why? Because all the devotees of Vrindavan, they are in at the bank of Kaliya Lake. And they are in anxiety by seeing the condition of Krishna. But after Krishna started dancing on the hood of Kaliya, their heart were overjoyed with ecstasy. And Krishna was very happy by seeing the devotees of Vrindavan so happy. And that is the purpose. Devotees of Vrindavan, they want to give happiness to Krishna, and Krishna wants to give happiness to his devotees in Vrindavan. So that is the reciprocation between Krishna and the Brajavasis. And they spend the night there, and next morning they went back to their places. So in that way, by performing this pastime, Krishna did so many wonderful things, and we learned so many lessons from this pastime. So what's our lesson from this? The primary lesson, the message of this pastime is that we should be free from envy. Envy, as long as we have envy, there is no vacancy in the spiritual world. Envy means no vacancy. So if we want to enter into the spiritual world, if we want to practice Krishna consciousness, we have to give up envy. And how it is possible? When we have the wonderful association of devotees, and when we hear about Krishna, because Krishna's mercy flows through his holy name. Krishna's mercy flows through his Harikatha. So when we hear about Krishna and it enters into our heart, the envy in our heart goes away. And that's why Krishna has performed these pastimes. Why? Because devotees in the future, they will derive benefit by talking about this pastime. And when you hear these pastimes and when it enters into our heart, what happens? We become purified. And that is the way of becoming, that is the way we can become free from envy. And as envy reduces, we experience the bliss and happiness of Krishna consciousness. The process is we have to reduce our envy and become free from envy, and we can experience the bliss of Krishna consciousness. And in that way, our life will become perfect. And at the end of our life, we can go back home, back to Godhead. So with that note, I'll conclude my discussion. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Krishna Chandra Bhagavan ki jai, Vrindavan Dham ki jai, Samaveta Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki jai, Nitai Gaur Premanande, Hare Hare Bo. If you have any question, you can ask, because day before yesterday, we did not have question answer session, and you have some time today. So if you have some question, you can ask.
Prabhuji, how many days it took to kill Kaliya?
Not days. So it was, he was in the coil, I think, for half an hour. Then he came out and he killed him. Not killed. Kali was not killed. Kali was subdued.
Yesterday I could not connect to Prabhuji. I don't know why.
Yesterday I did not. I was not there also.
Waiting for the host to start the meeting, like that it came.
It was not. Okay. Not there. Yesterday we did not have the session.
Okay. Prabhuji. Dhanyavad. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes,
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, yes. You told us before chanting we have to Achman. Achman that, before chanting.
That is not the topic. Last question on the topic.
Topic. Prabhuji, topic mein with the class question mein bataya tha apne Achman se related isme. Actually, Kaliya jab enter kiya tha uske andar, matlab Yamuna mein.
Haan, to kya hua? Kya hua tha?
Yes, I am noted, Prabhuji.
Achman, matlab usme jab Ben, matlab jumped, Krishna jumped in Yamuna, and before chanting, aapne bataya tha ki Achman bhi karna chahiye.
I spoke about Achman during Putana Uddhar. You're missing the point. When Putana was killed,
okay.
The elderly gopis, they did Achman and started chanting mantra. That was Putana Uddhar Lila, not Kaliyadam Lila.
Sure.
So what's your question?
Thank you, Prabhuji.
What's
no
your
question, Prabhuji, all that.
Okay. If you do some
actually Achman se related aapne bataya to
Achman means to purify ourselves. If you chant Gayatri, if you chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, you should put tilaka, then you should do Achaman. If you do puja, Achaman means you have to purify by chanting some mantras. That is called Achaman. Okay?
Before taking a bath, can we chant this Maha Mantra?
Yeah, you can chant Maha Mantra anytime. Mahaprabhu said there is no Des Kalapatra. But better, we should be clean and chant the Maha Mantra. That's better. Even if you don't take bath, then you should wash your feet, wash your hand, wash your mouth. If you sleep, then have a fresh cloth, then you should chant the holy name. That's best. But if you cannot do that, you can chant in any situation.
So, Prabhuji, I want to ask how will I free from envy?
Envy? I already told.
Yes, Prabhuji.
If you are envious, then you have to serve. So, our envy will go through service. And the best way to get free from envy is to hear about Krishna. If you hear Krishna Katha from a bona fide source, then our envy will slowly, slowly reduce. Okay?
Thank you
Krishna
so much.
Krishna Katha is a cure.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
And we should associate with those who are not envious. Good association and hearing Krishna Katha.
Hare Krishna. Krishna Katha.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
So, any more questions?
Yes.
Today is the last session of Prabhuji. So, devotees, if they want to ask questions.
He explained very nicely, Prabhuji.
Okay, that is a comment. Thank you so much. If you have any question, you can ask.
No, Prabhuji, thank you so much.
So it looks like there are no questions.
Yeah, then you can conclude.
No questions.
So we want to sincerely thank His Grace Sankarshita Prabhu for his wonderful association for last
Hare week. Krishna.
Yes. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Ram. Hare Ram. Ram Ram. Hare Hare. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Prabhu.
Let us chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and thank Prabhuji for his wonderful association. Hare Krishna, Hare
Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Krishna, Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram, Hare
Hare.
Thank you for very much for your association, Prabhu, and all your services you have been doing for the whole of society. Thank you very, very much.
I like to thank all the devotees, those who are hearing and tolerating me for the last 5 days. Thank you so much for hearing and coming every day and hearing Krishna Katha. Thank you.
Prabhuji. We got so many points. Thank you so many things.
If you got so many points, that is very good. If some benefit you have got, that's my... what I can say, that's my happiness that some service I have done. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
You are in Uchi, ISKCON Temple, Prabhuji.
Now I am in ISKCON Juhu, Mumbai.
Juhu, Mumbai. Okay.
Another session I was giving in Kanpur, UP. Today I am in Mumbai. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
You are from which part of the world? I did not check because many people.
I am from Andhra Pradesh, India.
I don't know Telugu. Otherwise, I would have spoken in Telugu.
I am from Chennai, Prabhuji.
You are from Chennai. I don't know Tamil, so.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. I am in Austin, Texas, USA.
Good. and English was the proper language. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
I am from Kerala, sir.
Oh, Malayalam. So, okay.
Prabhuji, I visited Wheeling, West Virginia. Wheeling, that is Palace of Gold, ISKCON Temple.
New Vrindavan.
New Vrindavan. Oh.
Prabhupada gave the name New Vrindavan.
New Vrindavan.
Okay, thank you so much.